hello and welcome to Pattingham, where this week we're celebrating the harvest. Now this is going to be the strangest harvest festival that any of us can recall, I'm sure. No special decorations in church, in fact no service in the building at all, unless it's pouring with rain on Sunday. Some of us will be gathering, I hope, instead on the village hall playing field for an open air service, which as far as we can will mirror this online worship. So wherever you are presently or however you're joining us, I hope you'll not feel you're missing out too much. The theme for this year is thank you to our farmers, and there can seldom have been a year when that was more heartfelt. They have kept going through awful weather conditions and pandemic to keep us fed. And it's great that we have a couple of them helping out with our service this year by reading for us. And I shall also be joined by our reader, Ken Scott, who is sharing in the leading of this act of worship, along with our organist, Greg Lewin, and the choir. So now let's prepare to begin our opening responses. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beneath the mists of time, before the world began, beyond our understanding, in the beginning, God. Fathering history, mothering creation, parenting Earth's people, from the beginning, God. Expecting the right moment, preparing the right way, revealing the right person for each new beginning, God. We believe in one God, maker and mover of heaven and earth. Amen. Now we listen as the choir sings the hymn, Come, Ye Thankful People, Come.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, choir, for that opening hymn. Now, a prayer. God, God the maker, maker of colour, sound, texture, quietness, and the restless beauty in living things, we bless you. God, God the maker of granite and mustard seed, of grey cloud and starlight, of earthquake and heartbeat, we bless you. God, God the maker of all that is unseen, of all that has been, of all that words can never capture, we bless you. God, God our maker, we, the children of your love, the creatures of your kindness, the guardians of your creation, bless you. We bless you for your making, your trusting, your loving, your never-ending goodness. Amen. So now I invite you to join with me in saying some selected verses from Psalm 8. O Lord our God, how glorious is your name in all the earth. Your majesty is praised above the heavens. On the lips of children and babies you have found praise to foil the enemy, to silence the foe and the rebel. When I look at the heavens, the work of your hands, at the moon and the stars which you have arranged, what are human beings that you should remember them, mere mortals that you should care for them? You have made them in your own image and crowned them with glory and honour. You have given them responsibility for your handiwork and put all things under their dominion. All of them. Sheep and cattle, yes, even the savage beasts, birds of the air and fish that make their way through the waters. O Lord our God, how glorious is your name in all the earth.
This lesson is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 7 to 18. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with brooks, streams, and deep springs gushing out into the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce, and you will lack nothing, a land where the rocks are iron, and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be thankful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large, and your silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land, with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you, so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth and so confirms his covenant which he swore to your ancestors as it is today. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, John. That's great. So, as we were talking about earlier, can you tell me one thing that's been really difficult with this year's harvest?
Well, the weather has been against us for quite some time, since last autumn, when it was very wet to get the crops in. And then we had that very dry spring, which the crops, because the crops had a wet winter, they didn't take root down into the ground. So, of course, they suffered with the drought.
Uh-huh.
And so, therefore, our yields were down quite a lot.
Right. But what's one thing that you're thankful for?
Well, I'm grateful to be still here and managing to keep from this virus.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Okay, that's great. Thank you, John.
And now we listen as the choir sings the anthem by Maurice Green, Thou Visitest the Earth.
Thou visitest the earth and blessest it, and blessest it, and crownest the year with thy goodness, and Christ the year with thy goodness. Thou visitest the earth, and blessest it, and blessest it, and crownest the year with thy goodness, and crownest the year with thy goodness. Thou crownest the year with thy goodness, thou crownest thy goodness.
So thank you, Dave, for agreeing to do this reading. Can you just tell us what this impressive bit of kit is that you're standing in front of?
Well, we're here to celebrate the harvest that's just been completed. And as one harvest is completed, so another starts. And this is the drill which is sowing the seeds for next year's crop, which we hope will be better than this year's.
Brilliant. Okay. Thank you very much. Off you go then.
So this is a reading from Luke chapter 12. Verses 16 to 30. Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he thought to himself, what should I do? For I have no place to store my crops. Then he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones. There I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat. Drink, be merry. God said to him, you fool, This very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich towards God. He said to his disciples, Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? If then you are not able to do so small a thing as that, why do you worry about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not clothed like one of these. If God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today, and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, you of little faith? And do not keep striving for what you are to eat and what you are to drink, and do not keep worrying, for it is the nations of the world that strive after all these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Thanks be to God.
That's lovely. Thank you, David. Okay. Well, I'll ask you the same questions I asked John. What's been really hard about this year's harvest? He said the weather.
Oh, yes, I'd endorse that. It's one extreme to the other.
Yeah.
This time last year, it was as dusty as it is now. We said, we could just do a little drop of rain. We did get a little drop of rain, but that was probably followed by several more inches. All winter. So
all winter, yeah.
Extremes of weather, I suppose, would be the thing for the last 12 months.
And one thing that you're really thankful for?
That we're still here. Given all the uncertainties of COVID, and we have a lot to be thankful.
Okay, that's brilliant. Thank you so much.
Harvest Reflection. It's been a hell of a year so far, one way or another. I don't think I've ever heard that sentiment expressed as often or in its various forms as I have this year, 2020. And ironically, 2020 should have been the year when we could develop our vision for the future. Our long-term view, developed strategies and plans. Instead of which, it's felt for much of the year as if we're in firefighting mode, fighting fires both real and metaphorical. And there's no prospect of it getting any better anytime soon. The real physical fires have blazed across Australia, across the Siberian tundra, and they're burning now, even as I speak, across the western seaboard of the United States. And the metaphorical fire that is the coronavirus pandemic is threatening again to engulf us all. And with all that going on, our farmers tell us that this has been one of the hardest years they can recall. Weather's been awful, both too wet and too dry. Crop yields have been disappointing in the main, although I believe the spring barley did pick up a bit. Prices are not good for producers, so it isn't easy, this year above all years, to think of things for which we want to give thanks and to do that with any enthusiasm. We can't even indulge ourselves by belting out all the familiar harvest hymns and anthems, although it is good to have the choir back in reality for the first time. But this is our harvest Thanksgiving. There won't be another for 12 months or more, so how can we make the best of it and remind ourselves that whatever the trials and tribulations we're living through in the short term, there is still a big picture out there. There's still a kingdom of heaven for which to fight and to strive for. There are still plenty of people who've yet to hear the good news that the gospel message we carry means good news for them too. And that's a beneficial virus that we'd do well to spread. Just imagine if faith in Jesus Christ could spread as rapidly as COVID-19. Now, that may sound a bit blasphemous, but the virus can teach us a thing or two, you know, about evangelism. Just imagine if each person infected with faith passed that faith on to at least two others. And our R number would be the number for whom the resurrection reality of Jesus Christ became real. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Earlier this week, we were told that by mid-October, the infection rate could increase to over 50,000. Well, 50,000 new believers would be a pandemic worth experiencing. But Harvest Festival is the time when we can stop, draw breath, look around and appreciate just how much we have, thanks to God and to our hard work. There's an old story about the country parson who, admiring the productive garden of one of his parishioners, said, "What a very good job you and God have done of that land. It's a fantastic display." "Ha," came the somewhat sarcastic response. "You should have seen the mess when God had it to himself." Well, that's the point of harvest, isn't it? Yes, we thank God for his goodness, for the many gifts he's bestowed on us, but we also thank our farmers for their skill and hard work. Skills and labour that have been sorely tried this year. And we thank those who work in distribution and haulage for ensuring that shelves do not run out of food, even when we behave in frankly ridiculous and selfish ways. We know how dependent we all are on those who keep food on our plates and power and heat available to us at the touch of a switch or a button. And this year we know too how dependent we are for our well-being on human contact and human relationships. Earlier this year, we all turned out on Thursday evenings to clap for our key workers in the NHS and caring industries. Remember that time? It would have been nice if our applause had been backed up by a little more in the way of financial reward for them, but it felt important at the time to express our regard and thanks in this way. Today, we can't sing our thanks to those who work on the land and to God, but at least we can show our respect and regard for the men and women who work the land so that we can be well fed and well watered. Let's clap for the farmers. We know that at times it has felt a thankless task this year to be stewarding the land under very difficult conditions. But we can't do without you. And you can't do without divine providence and blessing on your work. So thanks to the farmers, and thanks be to God. Amen.
Sweetly in the trees, where Our prayers to the God of the harvest. God of the harvest, God of the land, forgive our greed, our overbuilding and mass production, our wastefulness. Bless those who work on the land, farmers, fruiterers, labourers, and those who try to live and work by the seasons. God of the harvest, God of the seas, forgive our greed, our overfishing, and needless killing for unnecessary delicacies, our wastefulness. Bless those who work on the seas, sailors, fishermen and women, lifeboat crews, and those who try to live and work by the seasons. God of the harvest, God of the skies, forgive our greed and pollution, our desire for fast food delivery and excessive travel across the globe, our wastefulness. Bless those who work in our skies, pilots and air crew, helicopter crews. Bless our fair trade partners and those who try to live and work by the seasons. Make us ever mindful of the true cost to your creation, of our disconnection to time and place, of our disconnection from the seasons you created, of our disconnection from you, Creator God. We pray for reconciliation with the land, the seas, and skies. We pray for reconciliation between nations and a genuine sharing of resources. We pray for a reconciliation between ourselves and our Creator. We ask you to bless those who struggle to make a meagre living from a famished and drought-ridden earth, those who are made refugees and are forced to live as strangers in lands without hope, those in whose own land who struggle to make ends meet and are afraid for the future. Creator God, reconnect us to your creation, to its order and resources. Redeemer God, reconcile us to your creation, to each other and to you. Spirit God, renew us to live within your creation, aware of its seasons and our neighbors' needs. God of the land, God of the seas, God of the skies, bless us and make us a blessing to those in need within your created order. Amen.
Shall we say the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. And so now to close our harvest worship this morning, we have thanked God for his generous gifts to us. We have thanked God for the farming community and all who provide our food. We have thanked God for all that is good in our lives. And now we come to receive his blessing. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you this harvest time and always. Amen. Let us go and praise the Lord. Amen.